Good evening, and welcome to Phantom of the Opera Goes to the Opera, an exploration of some of the wonderful music of Andrew Lloyd Webber, along with a few classics of the more traditional operatic repertoire. I'm Ian Campbell, your host for the evening, and we've made one or two small changes to the program tonight, but I'm here to guide you so you won't get lost. You'll know exactly what's happening. You've just met our four fabulous singers, who will take you on this musical journey. Soprano Alexandra Raskazov, mezzo-soprano Pascal Spinney, tenor Matthew White, and baritone Eliomar Cuello, along with our wonderful collaborator and accompanist, Anna Fatieva. You'll find lots of information about them in your program, so read it at intermission, take it home, but don't try to read it in the dark. You'll meet all of them again very, very soon. Andrew Lloyd Webber composed musicals, Broadway shows. They were not operas. At least, that's what the purists said. But does it matter? What exactly is an opera anyway? Is it fully sung, as is La Bohème? Well, so are Evita, Les Mis, and Phantom of the Opera. Does a musical have dialogue, as does South Pacific? Usually true, but the original Carmen has dialogue, as do the Magic Flute and Fidelio. Does that mean they're musicals and not operas? When Webber was composing Evita, the head of English National Opera, Lord Harwood, told him that it belonged in his opera house. Did that make Evita an opera? Frankly, it doesn't matter. What does matter is that these are works that tell stories in song, whether they're fully sung or not. And when I ask many people what their favorite opera is, their response is Phantom of the Opera. Enough said. At the beginning of Phantom of the Opera, a chandelier is being auctioned off. It's the same one which will come crashing to the stage in a brilliant theatrical effect at the end of Act One. Did you notice that the chandelier's lot number for the auction is 666, the number of the beast or the devil? There actually was an accident at the Paris Opera in 1896 during a performance of Etienne Joseph Floquet's opera, L.A., at the Palais Garnier. A short circuit caused a counterweight from the chandelier to fall, killing a woman and injuring several more people. A journalist reporting on the event for the Paris newspaper was Gaston Leroux. He later wrote the novel, The Phantom of the Opera. Andrew Lloyd Webber's Phantom opened in London's West End in 1986, where it has given more than 14,500 performances, and it's still running. It stormed Broadway in 1988 and is the longest running show in Broadway history, approaching 14,000 performances. It celebrated its 35th anniversary just last month, and it's scheduled to close in April, but who knows? And a production of Phantom opens at the Shanghai Grand Theatre in April 2023 in the Mandarin language. So the music of the night continues. Let's turn to music and welcome our accompanist, Anna Fatieva. From Phantom of the Opera, Alexandra Raskazov will sing Christine's ode to her deceased father, wishing you were somehow here again.
Thank you.
We'll turn to Mozart now in one of his most popular works, Don Giovanni. We all know Giovanni was a great lover because Leporello details the number of women he has seduced in his Act One aria. In Italy, 640. England, 111. But Spain, Spain already leads with 1,003. We usually see the role of Giovanni sung by a mature kind of man who has had time to get around, but the singer of the world premiere in Prague was actually 22-year-old Luigi Bassi. Described as handsome and a skilled actor, he had sung the Count in The Marriage of Figaro in Prague the year before, when only 21. So he was clearly a remarkable young talent. But at 22, I doubt he would have had the time or the energy to achieve Giovanni's many conquests. In this duet, Giovanni sees the young Serlina at her pre-wedding celebration and decides to add her to his list of conquests. She resists briefly, but is soon overwhelmed by his charm and promises. But she's saved from a fate worse than death by the intervention of Donna Elvira. Pascal Spini and Eliomar Cuello sing La Ci Darem La Mano from Don Giovanni, accompanied by our one-woman orchestra, Anna Fatieva.
Quel casinetto è mio, soli saremo, e la gioiella mio, ci sposeremo. Ci darem la mano, non mi dirai di sì, e non è lontano, partiam anch'io da qui.
Andiamo, 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 andi
Weber's Aspects of Love premiered in April 1989. It's a story of passion, love, and loss in post-war France and Italy, and follows three generations of the Dillingham family spanning 17 years. Now, somewhat unusually for a Broadway show, it begins with what became one of its hit tunes. Now, Oklahoma had opened with Curly singing Oh, What a Beautiful Morning, and in South Pacific, Emile Debeck sings Some Enchanted Evening quite early in Act One, but we've already heard Dites-moi, A Cockeyed Optimist, and Nelly and Emile sing their twin soliloquies. But in Aspects of Love, we are launched immediately into a hit tune as Alex, age 34, sings Love Changes Everything. The show then goes into flashback to a time when Alex was 17 and he reflects upon his love for the actress Rose and their passionate affair. They learn that love, in its many forms, truly does change everything. Here are Seeing is Believing, sung by Pascal Spinney and Matthew White, and then Matthew sings the big hit Love Changes Everything from Aspects of Love. Thank you.
is everything. How you live and how you die. Love can make the summer fly, or a life you like a lifetime. Yes, love, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name.
Popular of Andrew Lloyd Webber's melodies owes its existence to Puccini. Webber had become fascinated with the fact that Puccini and Leoncavallo were writing their La Bohème operas at the same time, and he wondered if he could develop a backstage drama, perhaps, drawing on the rivalry, tension, and competition between the two composers. And while toying with the idea, he composed a melody in Puccini's style, but was unsure if he had heard it before or if it was truly original. Now, his father was an expert on Puccini, so he played it for him and asked if it sounded like anything. His father replied, "It sounds like $1 million." That melody became part of Memory in Cats. In the musical Grisabella, once a glamour cat is now an outcast, but remembers her good days. She's joined in the song by a young cat, Jemima, and is finally accepted by the others and will be reborn. But we're going to hear the solo version, which became a hit single. Here is Memory, sung by Pascal.
Moon lost her memory. She is smiling alone.
Let's return to Don Giovanni now and hear the great soprano aria Non mi dia. Donna Anna's father has been murdered by Giovanni, and she's having a very difficult time dealing with the tragedy. Her betrothed, Don Ottavio, rather insensitively, more or less tells her to get over it. It's God's will, that's the way things go, and let's get married tomorrow. When she hesitates, he accuses her of cruelty. This is too much for Anna, who says she loves him, but this is not the time to add to her anguish. At the end of the opera, she asks for another year to wait. It's a very demanding coloratura aria, and we're going to hear it sung with plenty of fireworks by Alexander Raskazov, singing Non mi dia.
Mi
Tim Rice, who had collaborated with Andrew Lloyd Webber on Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat and Jesus Christ Superstar, became fascinated with Ava Perón after hearing a profile of her on radio in the 1950s and suggested her as the subject of a musical. Webber was far from convinced, feeling that she was a somewhat hollow personality and wondered how to make an audience care about her at all. In looking for a device to make this possible, he recalled hearing Judy Garland in a disastrous concert in London in 1969. She arrived late, stumbled through her first songs, and the audience was clearly angry. She was confused and lost. When she started singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow, even her signature song failed to calm the audience, which Webber described as a vulture crushing a frail little sparrow. But her struggle impressed him. He knew he needed an anthem for Ava Perón, and that afternoon he wrote the slow tango melody of Don't Cry For Me, Argentina. Evita was underway. The song is really cynical, empty, full of self-pleasing platitudes, and yet remarkably engaging. As she finishes, a military officer sums it up by saying to her, "Statesmanship is more than entertaining peasants." Don't Cry For Me, Argentina is sung by Pascal. Thank you. Franz Leha was an Austro-Hungarian born in 1870. He was a prolific composer of operetta, the most popular of these being perhaps The Merry Widow, which premiered in Vienna in 1905. It's full of intrigue and misunderstandings, but at its core is the inevitable love between Danilo and Hannah. The music throughout is romantic, and the famous waltz, really a declaration of love, is a memorable highlight. As you recognize this beautiful melody tonight, you'll turn to the person beside you and whisper, "I know this one." You'll start to sway a little from side to side. You'll be tempted to tap your feet and maybe even hum along. Please don't. The Merry Widow Waltz is performed by Alexandra and Eliomar. Welcome back. I want to thank all of you for being here supporting Vero Beach Opera the way you are. And I hope you attended the terrific performance of The Elixir of Love last month. I was here, I thought it was absolutely wonderful. Now, some of you missed it, and we know who you are. And I think what you need to do is get on the mailing list, get on the email list, become a member, become a supporter, so you don't miss anything in the future. So please do it. Vero Beach Opera is very special, and we're lucky to have this company here performing such good work. Now it's time for more Phantom of the Opera and some of the popular music from this very memorable score. But please welcome back to the stage our incredible accompanist, Anna Fatieva. Anna. Now, the Phantom has sent a note to the management demanding that Christine replace Carlotta as the Countess in the new opera, Il Muto. But the owners of the theatre assure the furious Carlotta in our first excerpt, Prima Donna, that she will remain the star. In the show, it's a very strange kind of piece, somewhat music hall meets Gilbert and Sullivan combined in the first part, but we'll pick it up when Carlotta angrily says it's a plot to aid Christine. The second piece is seductive. Before he sings Music of the Night, the Phantom tells Christine that he has selected her to sing his compositions. Since the moment I first heard you, he says, I've needed you with me to serve me, to sing for my music. And we then hear a most hypnotic melody as Christine is put under his spell. The third excerpt in this bracket occurs after Christine has told Raoul about the Phantom and his influence upon her. Raoul tries to convince her it's merely a dream and nothing more, promising to protect her in a beautiful extended duet. Our ensemble performs Prima Donna, then Matthew sings Music of the Night, and finally Pascal and Eliomar unite in All I Ask of You.
Shouting your name, sing of holy. Thank you.
truly beautiful music and wonderfully performed. The first opera I ever heard was the UC Buelling Victoria de Los Angeles long-playing record of La Bohème by Puccini, and I'm sure many of you heard that same recording, conducted by Sir Thomas Beecham. A school teacher played it for me in 1960, and I was captivated. In 1964, it was the first opera I ever heard on a stage, and in 1981, the first opera I directed, so I love La Bohème. We're going to hear two excerpts now from this opera, the beautiful duet from Act One, in which Rodolfo and Mimi fall instantly in love in the moonlight flooding the attic in which he paints. We then go to the close of Act Three. Rodolfo has been telling his friend Marcello that Mimi is dying, and love is not enough to keep her alive. Unfortunately, Mimi has overheard it all. As Marcello leaves to see what the flirtatious Musetta is up to, Mimi tells Rodolfo she's leaving him. He cannot believe her as she asks him to bundle up her things except for the bonnet he bought her, which he may keep as a memento of their love. They agree to part, doing so rather quietly while remembering the good and the bad of their relationship. Meanwhile, their friends Musetta and Marcello angrily break up at the same moment, hurling nasty insults and accusations at one another. As snow falls and the act ends, Rodolfo and Mimi agree to stay together till spring, because to part in winter would be death itself. To sing O Soave Fanciulla, we have Alexandra and Matthew, who'll be joined by Pascal and Eliomar for Che Mimi Tu Qui.
Oh, Thank you.
On my bookshelves at home is a small volume published in Australia in 1888. It gives synopses and information about many operas, including one which had its premiere in 1875, only 13 years before the volume was published. The entry for this opera says, "The moral tone of the piece is low. The heroine's virtue has been scattered to the winds before the opera opens. When she appears, soldiers pay her compliments of the worst kind, and the music is not to everyone's taste." We'll now hear three excerpts from this great work, which I know you will recognize. First, in a sinuous and seductive melody, the heroine will tell us that love is a rebellious bird that nobody can tame. Then we meet a man who, for a time at least, is able to tame our heroine, stealing her from a soldier. And finally, the jilted soldier confronts the heroine outside a bullring and kills her. The opera, of course, is Carmen. Here are the Habanera sung by Pascal Spini, the Toreador song from Elio Marcueo, and the final dramatic duet with Pascal and Matthew White.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, these are singers with remarkable ranges and abilities, aren't they? They can sing almost anything. And of course, we owe a lot to this wonderful orchestra sitting here, Anna Fatieva. We return to Andrew Lloyd Webber now, and a show which began as a concept album but became a stage production which conquered the world and is frequently performed even today. It opened on Broadway in 1971, and the first London production ran for 8 years. The story, told entirely through song, explores the personal relationships and struggles between Jesus, Judas, Mary, Magdalene, his disciples, his followers, and the whole Roman Empire. It's Jesus Christ Superstar. In the opera, Mary Magdalene is presented as having an unrequited love for the title character and expresses her feelings and confusion in one of the best known songs from the show. From Jesus Christ Superstar, Alexandra Raskazov sings, "I Don't Know How to Love Him."
Yes, really changed.
Definitely, the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber is quite remarkable. There are many great melodies in all of his pieces, and it's too easy to say they're not worthy, but songs like that and some of the others we've heard tonight are really great examples of great composition. We return to now Giuseppe Verdi to close the program, which has explored many aspects of love and relationships. We'll turn to La Traviata and the Act One ensemble we know as Libiamo. Alfredo begins and is soon joined by Violetta and the rest of the party guests as they sing, "Let's drink, drink from the joyful glass which beauty embellishes, and let the fleeting hour intoxicate itself with sensual pleasure. Everything is folly in the world except that which brings pleasure." It's hedonistic and cynical, I suppose, but it's a great tune. Here is Libiamo, sung by Matthew, Alexandra, Pascal, and Eliomar, accompanied by Anna Fatieva.
Così